Everybody, please silence your cell phones and electronic devices as we can call this meeting to order. Good evening. My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and a divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles. They are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5, that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach according to the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Later on, he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern, practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Nanette Ramirez. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be 2 Corinthians, the 3rd and 4th chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Ramirez?
Good evening, class. Good evening. Let us all bow our hearts and minds in this moment of prayer. Thank you, Heavenly Father Yahweh, for allowing us to gather here today. We ask that you continue to open our hearts and our minds so that we may gain a profound knowledge of your purpose, pattern, and plan. All this we ask in your Son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you.
When I call him, it's in groanings that you can't hear. And when he answers, his voice dispels all fear. When I need him, he knows it right away. And I must confess, I need him every day. When I'm happy, he's every reason that I can smile, and I can get so misty. When I think on how he died, but if he hadn't done it, no, there'd be no joy, you see. I know that only his blood could atone for me. When I'm angry, his disposition will take control, and he can calm me the lullaby to soothe my soul. When I'm crying for fear that I won't pass the test, he says just keep the faith and let me do the rest. When I feel helpless and feeling sorry for myself, you know he scolds me, then lifts me up like no one else. When I'm tired, 'cause the rhythm of life has slowed my feet, Yahshua is all the inspiration that I need. Children sing that song of victory while I sing this song for free. And like the children sing that song of victory while I sing this song for free.
Good evening, class. A scripture lesson will be taken from 2 Corinthians, the 3rd and 4th chapters, page 239, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities in various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Tranum Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. 2 Corinthians, the 3rd and 4th chapter, page 239. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some other epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? Ye are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of the Messiah, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living Elohim, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And such confidence have we through the Messiah towards Yahweh. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of Yahweh, who also has made us able minister of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. But if the ministration of death, written and engraved in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remained is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in the Messiah. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when they shall turn to Yahweh, the veil shall be taken away. Now Yahweh is Spirit, and where the Spirit of Yahweh is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face beholding, as in a glass, the glory of Yahweh, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of Yahweh. Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of Yahweh deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of Elohim. But if our evangel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the spirit of this age has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious evangel of the Messiah, who is the image of Yahweh, should shine upon them. For we preach not ourselves, but the Messiah Yahshua, the Savior, and ourselves your servant for Yahshua's sake. For Yahweh, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of Yahweh in the face of Yahshua the Messiah. But we have this treasure in earthen vessel, that the excellency of the power may be of Yahweh and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of Yahshua, that the life also of Yahshua might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Yahshua's sake, that the life also of Yahshua might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak, knowing that he which raised up Yahshua shall raise up us also by Yahshua, and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundance grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of Yahweh, for which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I have read 2 Corinthians, the 3rd and 4th chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Ramirez, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. So today is Thursday. It's open testimony and slash lecture. So at this time, we'd like to open up the floor for anybody who is here with us or out there on Zoom with us to give a testimony. So I'll give a moment for anybody to speak up. Okay, well, I'll give a testimony. Good. That works. So, I miss coming down to the building as much. You know, I have been in regular attendance for a good period of time, and just recently I haven't been able to be in regular attendance with all of the responsibilities that I have, but it is truly always, you know, an honor, and it's a great privilege to be able to stand before the assembly of the body of Yahshua, the Messiah, and speak of anything that I've come to know since coming down to this school. And this scripture lesson tonight was powerful. The third and fourth chapter, 2 Corinthians. Ariel, can you hand me my book there, right in the corner of the table, please? But I'd like to get into that a little bit, but I went and I got to visit with Dr. Carl Emler out down in Oceanside, and we had a really good time. We did some work on his house, just a little bit of stuff. He did most of it himself, but I just came in with, you know, some of the heavy lifting at the end with putting in some rocks. He had a new backyard done, and the garden areas, he wanted to put in rocks instead of mulch or anything like that, and those rocks are pretty heavy, so I helped him with that so it wouldn't be too heavy on him. It wasn't a big job. We got it done in half a day, but it was good because we got to spend some time together. I got to find out how good of a cook he was, and had some blueberry pie, and we preached the gospel, and we talked about this school and some of the things that he had gone through and has experienced in his early years in the 70s of the school. And he was out in New York, and the dean of the school that he was part of was Burbank Mitchell, I believe. And it was a little bit different the way that they had their classes set up. They weren't doing the moderation the way that it's done now and is standardized here now. The prayer wasn't a standardized thing. The music wasn't standardized, and it had gotten to a point where the gospel was being preached in the school, but it got word got to Dr. Kinley that these things weren't happening. The moderation wasn't being done. The prayer wasn't being done. The doxology or benediction wasn't being done. And Dr. Kinley got upset. And this is just a conversation that I just had, and I'm regurgitating from with Carl, that kind of stuck with me, and how the reason why I'm even bringing it up is just the importance of going through the ritual of the production of class. You moderate, and you have a prayer, and you have a benediction at the end, and a song, but that we talked about the song too, but I'll get to that. So the moderation wasn't being done, and Dr. Kinley got upset, and he said, you know, we want the moderation. He wanted the moderation done every class because anybody new who come in, he wanted them to know what it was about. And he didn't want at any time, okay, it's all the same people, so we're not doing the moderation. And then somebody slip in the door and the moderation isn't done and they don't know what this thing is about and they get the wrong impression of what this organization, they think is a church. They, you know, it's already bad enough that people don't listen to the words that are coming out of your mouth half of the time. So they'll hear the moderation and not understand it. But at least you gave them the warning that this isn't a church. This isn't a place to wave your hands around. We're not worshiping here. We're learning something about our Heavenly Father. And then the prayer, the thing about the prayer that really hit me hard is he said this. He said, Doc said that if the person who does the prayer has the Holy Spirit, then that prayer will be answered. He didn't go into much more explanation of that, but you don't really have to if you understand that the Holy Spirit is that spirit of righteousness and truth, and that Holy Spirit is operating according to the pattern. He's in righteousness, not perverting that pattern in any way. So that prayer will be answered. And also with the moderation and the prayer, it prepares you to set aside that next 2 hours that you're going to be sitting down in the classroom to pay attention to what's being taught. And once that's all done at the end of the class, then you have the benediction or the doxology that we have. And what that does is, you know, you're praying for the time to learn and know something about Yahweh at that time that you're in the class. And you have that doxology that's opening you up to be allowed to start thinking about the other things that are going on. We don't want you sitting down here in the classroom thinking about what you're going to have for dinner, or, you know, how many days you got left to pay that car note, or, you know, whatever. You know, we want you to be focused on what's being taught so that you can learn something and improve something. And I really like this. I just took that away from Carl's that visit with Carl, and it's just the little things that, you know, really help strengthen my understanding as to, you know, the importance of this being a school, and, you know, in correlation with what Yahshua said, that take on my yoke. My burden is light to learn of me, you know. And what was it? I spent the night over at his house, and I woke up out of my sleep, and there was a verse that was stuck in my head, and I want to get it right now because it's not stuck in my head right now, but I wrote it down. John 17:3, please.
John 17:3.
Mm-hmm.
And this is life eternal, that they might know that thou only art the true El, and Yahshua the Messiah whom thou hast sent.
That's a big statement. This is life eternal. We're not at this school preaching prosperity to you in the earth plane. We're not about that down here. We're down here preaching eternal life. And I heard Doc say that people can get that confused and think, oh, well, they're preaching on how to, like, never have to take off this physical body. But no, it's not what. Everybody who was born into the flesh and into the world has a date with that death. They're going to take off this flesh. The flesh and bone is going to go back to the earth. But we're preaching eternal life in the spirit. And we got a book that we read out of that, as Will Williams liked to say all the time, is the world's all-time best-selling book. But at the same time, it's the least understood. And that's why you've got so many different versions and variations of these different books. You got your Vulgate, you got your King James, you got your Holy Name Bible that we got right here. And the fact of the matter is, none of them are all the way right. None of them are telling you what you need to know if you don't have the prophetic vision and revelation to understand what's being written. Then you're dead in the water. It makes no sense. And what we're doing at this school is helping you to find and know Yahweh for who he is and how he actually exists. And we make the claim that we know this. We know who he is, and we know how he actually exists. And how do we know who he is, and how do we know how he actually exists? That is as a result of the divine vision. Because we all have visions. You open up your eyes, you're looking, you're on YouTube or Zoom right now, and you're looking at this lecture or testimony. You're seeing this in a vision. We all have revelations. When you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth, I'm revealing what I'm thinking. That's a revelation. Do you understand it in truth? Do you have a profound understanding of the things that are being said? And is what I'm saying right? Is it accurate? Is it correct? These are things that you ought to be doing the investigation on as I speak, because this is a school and it's not some place where you just go to worship and you just blindly follow and whatever I say is the way that it is wrong. No, that's not it. Like, we want you to discern whether it is that spirit of righteousness, the Holy Spirit, that is speaking. And I don't want to project what Sean feels in any way, because I realize that Sean's wrong all the time. He's never right. And it took me coming down here to understand something about Yahweh's purpose to realize that the things that Sean thought was right, whether I was a good guy and I didn't want to hurt anybody and, you know, any of those things like that, I wanted to provide for the people that were around me, it still was not right. I was still off the mark because I didn't realize that there is a spirit that is greater than me, that is operating, that is greater than my persona, if you will, that is operating this physical body, which is a wheel within a wheel. If you like this out here in the wilderness, you got this kingdom, this tabernacle being a wheel, and you got all of these tribes, three on each side, camped around here, and you got a wheel within a wheel out here. You've got up here, you've got Yahshua or Yahweh Elohim taking on shape and form, but he's getting everything that he got from Yahweh. So you got a wheel within a wheel here, and you want to see, you've got Romans 1, 19 and 20, please. And it was at the end of our scripture lesson, it talked about it, so I want to get back to that, but go ahead.
Romans 1:19.
Please.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh mm-hmm. is manifest in them.
Right.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Mm-hmm.
For the invisible things of him from creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made,
even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
So that there's no excuse. We want you to see this thing clearly. The things that are made, the physical things, this physical body that I have standing here, yours, and everything in the universe, points back to the spiritual reality of our Heavenly Father, Yahshua, and that's what we want you to see. And that's what Yahweh wants you to see as well. The promise was given to Abraham that through his seed, all of the families of the earth will be blessed if they believe the report. Because, see, his seed was cast down into darkness and evilly entreated to only to be brought out through the divided waters of the Red Sea to tarry in the wilderness of Sinai for 40 years and then cross this River Jordan right here, the divided waters of the River Jordan, to inherit the promised land, Canaan's land, or Jerusalem. Jerusalem below being this Jerusalem and this trek that they went through being a physical trek that they went through, which points to Jerusalem above. Because it's because all of the things that they did and every step that they took from going out of Canaan's land down into Egypt and then back into Canaan's land was according to the pattern that our Heavenly Father took on shape and form as Elohim and created everything in the entire celestial and terrestrial universe. So we have this as a witness to that. That's what we're talking about that's what's being talked about in Romans 1:19 and 20. And I'm just fumbling around in my book here to find 2 Corinthians. Okay. I've been so lazy not putting my little tab things in there because I need those index tabs. I want to get. I'm there now. So start at 1, please. 3 and 1. And I don't want to take longer than an hour. So ring me down, please. Because I'll go. All right.
Do we begin again to commend ourselves? Or need we, as some other epistles of accommodation to you, or letters of accommodation from you?
Do we commend ourselves? No, we don't want to commend ourselves. That's a question that we should kind of meditate on a little bit. Because you come down to this school and you learn something about Yahweh for who he is and how he actually exists. And then it's possible to get puffed up and think, I know something. And then you go out into the world and you see somebody who's in a church and they're dancing around and they worshiping and they look praising idols and, you know, holding rosaries. And you look down on them a little bit and then you commend yourself like, I'm glad I'm not doing that stuff there. And then they're over there doing that. I'm not going to mess with that. Do we commend ourselves? Why? No. You got the knowledge that you got from Yahweh. And he could take it away just as much as he got it. Tell him I said to let you play. Read, please.
Ye are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of the Messiah ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living Elohim, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart.
We are manifestly declared to be the epistles, which is the book, written in the book of life. We don't want to be blotted out of the book of life. And you puffing yourself up, vain in your imagination that you're better than somebody else, is a good way to risk something like that happening. You know, because you're blocking the truth that Yahweh is a Yahweh for everybody. He's eternal. So that person, where they may be following these vain rituals or whatnot, they're the same, they're made of the same same substance as you. And they're here for Yahweh's purpose. Mm-hmm. So don't get puffed up. We are ministered. We're epistles of the Messiah. And we're ministered by, not with these laws. I'm trying to get this right. Not with these laws, these statutes, judgments, and ordinances, and these things that condemn you and whatnot, but the living Elohim, according to divine intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. Not water baptism, physical sacrifices, and, you know, different ceremonies and things like that that you have to go through, feasts and festivals and so on, and recognitions of moons and things like that. That all of those things point to the spiritual thing. The physical points to the spiritual, and that's what we're doing down here with the pattern of the tabernacle. Keep on reading, please.
4. And such confidence have we through the Messiah towards Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as ourselves, but our sufficiency is of Yahweh.
Read.
Who also has made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life.
All of these carnal ordinances, this law that was given to these Jews, it was given to the Jews, and it was given to the Jews only. It wasn't for, if you weren't a Hebrew, to this day, it's not for you. If you're not Hebrew, it's not for you. It's only for the Jews. And that's why that promise was given to Abraham, that in his seed, all of the families of the earth would be blessed, because through his seed, they had to go through this journey. And what we're reading about here is that you got this law of Moses in this third and fourth chapter that, when the Jews, when they don't recognize that Yahshua fulfilled this law, that he walked the earth plane for the 33 and a half years fulfilling, Doc said it this way. If you wrote in a book all of the things that Yahshua did, it wouldn't, the world couldn't contain the books. Mm-hmm. There was so much that he did. Yeah. He fulfilled, and to take this law of sin and death out of the way, that 10 commandments and 603 statutes, judgments, and ordinances, they were unto their righteousness if they could do it, but they couldn't do it. So the man himself who gave them the law had to come down in a physical body and fulfill the law and take it out of the way and usher in a new covenant. Mm-hmm. Not written in ink. That's what we just read right here. Mm-hmm. But written in our heart. And we're not sufficient to ourselves of anything, because you come in here, you don't know nothing about it. And even if you, after you get something about it, without the repetition and the foolishness of preaching, and the rightly dividing the word of truth, you still, you might lose it. You think you got something, and all right, I'm done, and I'm walking on to myself now. And then a couple years later, you're like, hey, man, I know I need to get back down there. You see somebody who you went to class. I know I need to get back down there. You don't remember none of that stuff. That you might remember something, a little remnant of something. Get back into class. You know, this. We it said many times. I believe Dr. Salas, the last time that he spoke, got on the floor and he said, this is a school that you don't graduate from. And it's got to be that way because we're going on. This is where we're at right now. And we can prove it. This is where we're at. It is spiritual kingdom on earth. You can be in hell on earth, but if you have Yahshua and you understand the report and you understand what he was doing in dying and being buried on that phenomenal day and then resurrecting early Sunday morning and then tarrying for 40 days, being seen by the multitudes as a witness to him being resurrected. And he wasn't resurrected a physical man. He was resurrected a spiritual, a quickening spirit. And then him ascending into heaven and 7 days later pouring out his Holy Spirit on Pentecost, first to the Jews, and then later to the Gentiles. 7 years. 7 years later to the Gentiles. See, the Jews, instead of, when he poured out his Holy Spirit, he took water baptism out of the way and replaced it with a spiritual baptism. And the way that his Spirit was poured out was through the preaching of the gospel. He explained to those people what he did. And those that believed what he did and understood and had a profound knowledge through searching the scriptures, through knowing the law, through reviewing the report. Those who have who believed what Yahshua did, they were given the gift of the Holy Spirit. Not being bound to sacrifices and foot washings and ceremonies and things of the sort anymore. Not being condemned in their consciousness, knowing that this pattern is a pattern of holy things, that everything in the universe is made according to this pattern. Being able to have, as Yahshua, acting as an intercessor to show and give you an understanding of what this is that you're looking at right here on this chart. That's what we want. We want you to understand what this is, what this points to, that this points to our Heavenly Father. In everything that you do is a witness to this. I came over here. Read.
Okay. 7. But if the ministration of death, written and engraved in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory.
The ministration of condemnation, you still got people, it's glorious because you still got people following around. It don't sound glorious when you read it on paper. If you don't know nothing about it, when you read it out of the book, the ministration of condemnation, that sounds like something I don't want to be a part of, you know. But that's what this is.
building this tabernacle, following it around all around the wilderness, got to put it together, take it apart, and you know, got to have sheep and goats and all these different things to sacrifice to it. You got to go through the circumcision on the eighth day, and if it's the Sabbath day, you're screwed. Like all of these different things, there's condemnation every which way that you go if you don't do it. Now, if that's glorious, how much more is the ministration of righteousness? How much more does that exceed in glory? And that's just understanding. That's just knowing. That's what he says. He said, I said it already. He said, take on my yoke and learn of me. Mm-hmm. You know, now we have the ability to have that revelation according to the vision. You can look at these charts. You can have a divine vision. You got the divine vision right here on these charts. Now, it takes Yahweh to give you the revelation, the understanding of these charts. And that's what we're teaching at this school. Go ahead and skip down to 12.
Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech.
We've got hope. And that's why we about to break this thing down. We don't want to get up here and say something about a topic and then it not being understood, and then you walk out of here without an understanding of what it is that we're talking about. If you got a question about something, since this is a school, ask it. And we ought to have the patience with one another to labor and break this thing down until you can understand it, and not walk away from it until you got a plain understanding of the thing that it is at hand. Read.
And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished.
That's a type and shadow. He had to put a veil over his face because they weren't ready. They weren't ready for this. They weren't ready for this. They could not contain this glory. They had a carnal mind. So they had to have a carnal law. And they had and it had to be done to show back to Yahweh. They went through this. It was for the Jews and the Jews only to be an ensample. It just had to be done. And they weren't, and he had to put a veil over his face because they weren't ready to see it yet. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament.
Now, this was written, almost 2,000 years ago, and it's still. Are you down here following these circumcisions, these ceremonies, these baptisms, the Passovers? Nobody wants to do the sacrifices no more because you get, you know, them dirty and whatnot. You need a washing machine in the sanctuary for that. And the Ten Commandments. Are you still doing all of these things? That veil is still on you today. Read.
Which veil is done away in the Messiah.
That veil is done away in the Messiah because he fulfilled this law. He completed this law. Give me Romans 8:1.
Okay. Romans 8:1.
Mm-hmm.
There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah.
There's no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah. We just read back here in 2 Corinthians 3:9, for if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. If you're in Yahshua the Messiah, there is no more ministration of condemnation. You're in the ministration of righteousness. And you have to understand that. You have to understand that about this pattern. Yeah, what did he read? What is that? Think not that I am come to destroy, please. It's 5:17 something. Was that John 5:17?
Matthew.
Matthew. I always get him. I always get him mixed
Matthew
up.
5:17. Think not that I am come.
Yeah, King James. Yeah, there you go. Right there.
Joshua is speaking. He said, think not that I am come to read.
Destroy the law or the prophets.
Think not that I am come to destroy this ministration of condemnation. Read.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
He didn't come to destroy this thing. He came to fulfill. He came to complete. He came to pay off that car so you could take it home. You ain't got to pay for it no more. You ain't got to work on it no more. It's yours now. He came to draw this thing out so that you can understand something about it. So that you can learn something about it. So that there's a witness that there's somebody who can do this thing, because there was nobody who could do it. That's what makes him so great, is that he was the only one that could do it. And those Jews still believe to this day that he couldn't. They don't think he's come yet. So that they still stuck doing it to this day that we just read. Okay, now go ahead back into 2 Corinthians, please. 16, I think. No, 15. Yeah.
Right. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, when they shall turn to Yahweh, the veil shall be taken away.
Nevertheless, when they shall turn to Yahweh, that veil, because they're looking at Moses. So when they turn to Yahweh, as Moses said, at the divided water, at the Red Sea, before those waters divided. I don't know where I get this stuttering thing coming from. But he said, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh. Don't look at me. I just got you here. I was told to do this thing. Now, you turn away from Moses and you look at Yahweh, which that's who this is right here. That's what we want to know. Your baby Jesus is not Mary and Joseph's little boy.
Right.
And his name is Yahshua. And Yahshua means Yahweh is salvation. Yahweh is your Savior. And this is Yahweh manifest in a physical body. This is the spirit of righteousness, peace, and joy made manifest in a physical body in the likeness of sinful flesh without sin. He wasn't any of Mary and Joseph's DNA.
Right.
And he came into the world to fulfill this law, not to destroy it. He gave it in the first place so that you could know something about him, so that the things, the Romans 1:19 and 20 of it, the things that are made can explain this, like this is made, the things that are made can explain the invisible things of Yahweh. All right, let's get back into the scripture lesson.
17.
Yes.
Now Yahweh is spirit.
That's what we say in the moderation, right? Read.
And where the spirit of Yahweh is, there is liberty.
There is liberty. There is justice. There's righteousness. There's truth. There's peace. There's understanding. Read.
But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of Yahweh, are changed into the same image from glory to glory.
As in an open glass, we're changed into the same image. Why is that said like that? Because everything is made according to this pattern. Nothing escapes this pattern. And the person who wrote this right here understood that. That looking at this pattern, you can see that we are all, read that again.
But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of Yahweh.
Look up open face, please. Can we look up and see if we can get a definition of open face? I don't even know what it is for sure, but I'm certain it's good.
Verse
We all, with open face, which open face in to me, you know, I want to get it right. I don't want to be guessing at anything, but is to just receive something like, you know, when you got a mask covering up or the veil that Moses had, you can't see. You take that veil off, you got an open face. Now you can see.
Sincerity.
That's if we find it. Yeah. I mean, and in context, if you can't find it, that's fine. We just got done talking about Moses having a veil over his face. And then we go on and we say, we all with open face with that veil being removed. Did you find something on it?
Yeah, there's a few.
Okay, go ahead. Let's get. That's what Dr. Salas says. He's always
having a side covered and open face sandwich.
Yeah. Now you're trying to make us hungry. Open faced. Okay. So having sincerity. With beholding as in a glass the glory of Yahweh are changed. We are changed from our own theories, our concepts and opinions of the way things, we believe things to be over here in the father of lies and mystery Babylon, steeped in confusion, wanting to know something about God, but not knowing, not having a profound understanding. But according to this pattern that was given to the Jews, that was given according to the Abrahamic promise, and the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, fulfilling that kingdom of that tabernacle that they had to camp around in the wilderness, giving that open face, taking that veil off, renting that veil and giving some understanding so that you know there's no confusion anymore. You know who your Heavenly Father is. Mm-hmm. And you know that you're made just in His image, in His likeness, through and through, to every fine, minute particulate that is of your physical existence. Read.
Are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of Yahweh.
That's right. Go, okay, fourth, go to five. Skip down to five, because I don't want to take all of the
four
time.
And five?
Yeah.
For we speak not ourselves.
We but preach not ourselves. We don't. That's what I said when I got on the floor. We don't preach. I don't want to talk about Sean. Read.
But the Messiah, Yahshua, the Savior.
What we preach, the Messiah, Yahshua, the Savior. There may be some that profess that Henry Clifford Kinley is your Savior. Henry Clifford Kinley had the Holy Spirit in abiding within him. You can prove that by his works. But he himself told you that he's not your Savior. And he's nothing more special than anybody else. And he died just like the rest of us are going to. And nobody in this organization is any better or any worse than anybody else in the world. And even when it comes to the different religious sects out in the world. We're not a religious sect. We're a school.
Right.
We're a religious and scientific research organization. But since we talk about Yahweh, people get us confused with being a religion. Mm-hmm. Bringing you back to something that you didn't have. You lost or whatever, but the reality is, the proof is that this in this pattern, once you understand it, you never lost anything.
Right.
You're just steeped in darkness and not understanding that you already are that which you're looking for. Go ahead and read, because that's what we're about to.
And ourselves, your servants, for Yahshua's sake.
Mm-hmm.
For Yahweh, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of Yahweh in the face of Yahshua the Messiah.
For Yahweh, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, give me John 1 and 3 or 4, please. Yahweh commanded the light to shine out of darkness. And see, in the beginning of this creation was the Word. And the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. That's this word, this super incorporeal, real Elohistic shape and form. This is Yahweh taking on shape and form, not being created, because Yahweh is eternal. The darkness was created. This was not. So what we're reading here is Yahweh commanded the light, which was there from the beginning, to shine out of the darkness. How did he do that? He gave this tabernacle pattern, had these Jews bound to this thing, and then came on down and got into a physical body and fulfilled this thing to show those who believe the report that this is the light. No man can get to the Father except through the Son. You have to go through him to get to him, and we needed this law to be there in order for you to see who that Son is, so that you can point it out. In 5:39, that Dr. Love, John 5:39, he says, "Ye search the Scriptures."
Right.
For in them ye think ye have eternal life, right. But there they, these scriptures that read the law, the first five books of the Bible, and the prophets, that all talking about this law, leading up to this law, and all the way up to when Yahshua the Messiah was walking on the earth plane, they are that would testify of him.
Right.
It was all written about him. So that you could see what he was doing. So that darkness that they were in, like the veil that was over Moses' face, that light could shine out of that darkness and reveal to them, you are what you're looking for. The physical things explaining, the visible things explaining the invisible things. Did I have you holding something?
John.
Well, you called John 1 and 3.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
4.
Yeah, I just went. Go ahead, read, please.
John 1 and 3.
Mm-hmm.
All things were made by him.
All things were made by that word that was with Yahweh and was Yahweh. Everything was made by him. That's what we're reading right here in Corinthians. Read.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Now, if you don't know that, you're in darkness. Read.
In him was life. And the life was the light of men.
In that word that made everything was life. We're preaching eternal life down here. And that life was the light of men. Read.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
That darkness didn't comprehend that light. But once Yahshua died, was buried, resurrected, and ascended, and outpoured his Holy Spirit on those who believe the report, that light began to shine out of darkness. The 10th aim of the school is for, I don't know why I do it so good, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah. That's what's now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Like, we are working to know something about who our Heavenly Father is. We're endeavoring to learn something about Yahweh. And the only way that you have the opportunity to do that is through his only begotten son, Yahshua. Not Kinley, not Harris, not Hudgenwortel, not Love, not Alanese, not Riser, not IDMR Incorporated, or anything like that. Yahshua. Through the, and you have to understand that according to this pattern and have a profound understanding of the unity of that spirit of Yahshua. That same spirit of Yahshua being the source, the substance, the limits and bounds of everything. Taking on shape and form, in part, not in totality, and then manifesting in a physical body in righteousness and truth. He knew everything about who he was. Do you? No. I can answer that for you. No. Unless you've had a divine vision and a divine revelation from Yahweh himself, then no, you don't. Just take a couple more minutes here, and then I'll take my seat. Where were we at in 2 Corinthians? Oh, 6. Continue. Yeah, start 6 again, please. This is a great scripture lesson.
For Yahweh, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts.
That light, that illumination has shined in our hearts. Because that old law was written on tables of stones and carnal fleshly ordinances. That light is shining on our hearts. And new, it's not written in pen and ink. It's written in our hearts and minds. That light is shining in our hearts. We have that illumination and that understanding that it's not a physical thing. It's a spiritual thing. Read.
To give the light of the knowledge of the glory of Yahweh in the face of Yahshua the Messiah.
That's what I just said. It's right there in the book. Read that again. Just go ahead and read that again from start 6 from the top.
For Yahweh, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of Yahweh in the face of Yahshua the Messiah.
That's right. In the face of Yahshua the Messiah. Given the knowledge of the glory of Yahweh in the face of Yahshua the Messiah, because Yahweh is salvation. Yahshua is our Savior. Okay. Let me see right here. I know we. All right. I think that's good for that. Now, give me John 17 and 3 one more time, and I want to show you a parallel that I had when I woke up out of my sleep. And I woke up out of my sleep, and I was having I had an earworm when I was over at Carl's house. An earworm it sounds gross. But it's what happens when, like, some lyrics to a song or something like that gets on a loop, and it just keeps playing over and over and over again in your head. And if that's ever happened to you, that's called an earworm. Like like it can be a whole song, it can be the chorus of a song, but it actually denotes signs of healthy brain activity. So if you ever have that, then that means there's something that's working right up there. But I woke up with this earworm, and it was the song that we had played in class earlier. This is life eternal. You know, and that was just going over and over in my head. And the conversation that Carl and I were having before we went to bed was about how he woke up out of his sleep upon hearing the name of Yahweh from a friend and was like, where is he getting this Yahweh thing from? And it woke him up out of the bed and made him go to his book. And he looked at the glossary in the back, the index in the back,
and he looked up. The person that talked to him had him reference Exodus 6 and 3, where it says, by my name Jehovah, it wasn't known. And that's what all he knew was Jehovah. So he looked up Jehovah in the back of the book, and it said Yahweh. And he was like, he did one of those. So it was like, so it was funny because I went to sleep, and I woke up out of my sleep in the same kind of sense, and this song, this earworm is going on in my head, and then I was just thinking, this is life eternal, this is life eternal, and I was like, I got to look up that scripture and read the whole thing. So read that one more time, and then I'll get to my point, and I'll take my seat.
John 17 and 3, And this is life eternal, that they might know that thou art the true El, and Yahshua the Messiah, who thou hast sent.
This is life eternal, that they might know. See, you want to know something, and that's why we're in a school, because when you go to school, you go to learn something. I tell my kids, you're not there to meet friends and make friends at school. You're here to learn something. That's your job at school, and that's what your job is here. So when you listen, when you hear the moderation get started, and you hear that prayer, prepare yourself to learn something when you come down to this school, and please be on time if you can. We know that we got jobs and traffic and things like that, but this school is teaching you that everything in this school, in the moderation, it says, in this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made according to the structure and function of this tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. And what you use this pattern to know something about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Now read Exodus 25 and let them make me a sanctuary. I think it's 8. 25 and 8, and then I'll sit down.
Exodus 25 and 8. Mm-hmm. And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them.
This is
them.
Yahweh telling Moses what to do with the Jews when he goes back down out of this mount. On that 40-day trip that he was up there, let them make me a sanctuary, read.
That I may dwell among them.
That he may dwell among them. Now, when you are at home with your mama, if you got a daddy in the house, you know him, right? And life eternal is to know. Now, if you got this tabernacle that he may dwell there, that's when he dwells there, then you can know him. That's the parallel. When you have this pattern, he can dwell with you, so you can know him to have life eternal through his son. I hope and trust that something was got out of what was said. Hallelujah. I'm the moderator. For our next speaker, it will be the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marla Love.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Happy to be here once again, as always, that Yahweh has allowed us to gather, to learn more about his purpose, his pattern, and his plan, and his righteousness, whereby we are to become subject unto, leaving our old past as was expressed with the previous speaker. I appreciated the previous speaker's remarks and where he's looking at in order to minister the truth by which he's received. And in doing so, we've all come this far because we have received something. Mm-hmm. We have seen something. Mm-hmm. We have heard something. As such, as so says the book, he that has eyes to see and ears to hear, let him hear and let him understand. You follow? And that's what we're doing. We're coming into an understanding. And what we want to do, we want to keep the same mythology, the same path, the same way. We say a pattern. Moses saw this creation based off of a pattern. Once he was told about it there in Exodus, the 25th chapter, when this chart was drawn, it was placed here for us to see that there was a pattern that Moses was looking at according to the how the days of the creation was drawn out. And this pattern is a repeat. Follow? And the previous speaker made a comment when he started his discourse. And we said it in the moderation. And like the previous speaker said, you know, our clothing, our moderation, our song, our prayer, our scripture reading is to help you. Mm-hmm. Is to help you get settled in your mind so that you can begin to hopefully to pick up what the lecturer is going to talk about and discuss. People like all the fanfare because they get to come and socialize and hang out and talk with one another. But really, that's what it's set up for. And it's a pattern. You get into a pattern of getting yourself or our consciousness settled enough in order to receive the gospel. Because we're not giving money out here. We're not teaching you how to make any money. It's not a prosperity of prayer, of how to say a prayer. But yet prayers can be answered. And see, the prayers that we ask of Yahweh is to understand. That's the only prayer going on that's being answered.
That's right.
You follow? You're not asking for luxuries and bills to be paid and get me through the day and help my boss get fired or whatever the thing might be. We're not asking. We might ask, but they're not being answered to that degree. You follow? But what's get answered, and what I've learned from a little one, is understanding. Because when you have that understanding, as Joshua said there in the 11th chapter of Matthew, I believe, down to the 28th verse or so, he said, take my yoke upon me and learn of me. And we all see in what the previous speaker said about learning of him, and we have to use this migratory pattern. You follow? Based off of this tabernacle that Moses saw in the vision that he had read just now in Exodus 25:8-9, right? And how this tabernacle was a tabernacle of heavenly things, spiritual things. You follow? Whereby we're supposed to worship Yahweh in spirit and in truth. So therefore, he's given us a pattern to go by and to use in order to bring about spiritual things. Now, he also established the one story. Because we know we start that Bible with Exodus, the 3rd chapter. Because we got to pick up a name. We have to understand that that name of Yahweh is not some fly-by-night name. It's not no superhero name. It is the name of our creator of heaven and earth. Bar none. Not equal to none. And it was given to the first man known as Moses, who subsequently wrote Genesis. And all that you hear about with Adam and the transgression, about Noah and that flood, about Abraham and Melchizedek, about that promise. Moses wrote that. It wasn't passed down. It wasn't told by bonfires around, you know, the city of Enoch or anything like that. I mean, not going to the library and figuring out some other book of the Apocrypha or the other lost books of the Bible, as they like to purport them to be, as though you're going to extract a wealth amount of information from that. But what we're talking about is that we've given it a straight shot story. We don't have to go all around Jack Robinson's barn in order to justify anything. We just got to use what's been given to us. Now, I like to use the textbook because this is a great tool. If you go to volume 1, page 128. Sorry, Sean, I didn't let you know prior to. We're going to pick up volume 1, 126. We're going to read 127. So on two different pages. So show the picture of this pattern of this tabernacle. What do I want? Yeah, give me the plate 3. Got a half an hour. I just want to zip through this right quick because this is a school. And if you see the connection of why this works, that was given to us, it may bode something well. Now, hold on. This pattern was given to Moses. And this is a pattern of everything, like we said in the moderation. By this pattern, we can explain everything in the universe. Okay? Now, we have this migratory trek of the children of Israel that started up here in Canaan's land. Okay? And we know that this body of people, 70, came down into Egypt. Subsequently, they multiplied down here in Egypt. You follow? And remember that initially there was no problem, meaning they didn't come down and start building pyramids and struggling because Joseph was down here. And remember, Joseph was the second in charge to Pharaoh. He was the Lord of the bread because it was a famine for why they came down, as it would appear was a famine. But seeing what the previous speaker talked about that pricked me to see that the invisible thing, because he had Romans 1:19 and 20 read, you follow? And he said he showed it to them being the children of Israel. That's why he selected them, because that's why they're going to be our example. You follow? And this is why the Jews are a peculiar people and why they were used. Because when you use them and see what they were going through from Egypt, through this divided waters of the Red Sea, tearing around here in the wilderness of Sinai for 40 years, and then you got to remember here that the offspring, the principle, what came over into Jerusalem, which was the promised land, right? They didn't come from out of Egypt, save 3, Caleb, Phinehas, and Eleazar. All that other body of people, dead in the wilderness. So when we're expressing that this migratory pattern or this Moses chart takes our picture. And we've been admonished by many people. Even Doc said, hey, you got to take this information off the chart and apply it to yourself. And what we're expressing is when we use the children of Israel having come down out of Egypt, landed here in the court roundabout, come through this first veil, or through this door, excuse me, come through this door into the holy place, and we tarry for 40 years, or some such time as we come into this gospel and hear the sounds of this gospel, and it changes you. That's that change that has to be done before you cross that veil. Because as has been expressed, Satan and nothing imperfect is going to enter into the most holy place. That's described because here, remember, how many people was running in and out of the most holy place?
The high priest only.
Only one. The high priest at the then known time was the only one. How many times was he going up and out here throughout the day?
One time a year.
So this ain't for just any old and every old body. Just because you think that that Bible is talking to you, don't mean you in the holy place. In the most holy place, I prefer to say. So we have a work, and this is what this migratory pattern is for. You have a tabernacle pattern, and you have a migratory pattern. And as we read this migratory pattern on 127, 128 in the textbook, it has these two side by side. Isn't that a coinkydink? You follow? Now, also, the other speaker previously talked about Matthew 5:17, that he's come in to fulfill the law and the prophets, or the scriptures, in other words. You follow? That has to be understood, and this is what the previous speaker, and this is why 2 Corinthians works, and why it resonates, is because we're looking and being taught a spiritual reality according to what one Yahshua the Messiah performed and did. And as we begin to see how he did it, we begin to have the faith in who he is. And you have to use this because this is where he's at, because he's walking with them. He's never left his creation since he came into the body of Adam. He came down and walked down. And so what we're saying is, don't look at these events in time as some simple story. Because, hey, everybody knows about the story of Moses. Got on TV, and they know the outer clothing of that book, because everybody has the Bible. And I say they know about Moses according to a topical expression. But we're going to be looking at Moses and the children of Israel according to a spiritual reality, according to a tabernacle pattern. And then when we see how this pattern and this migratory pattern worked, why it was instituted, and how Yahshua fulfilled it, then it ought to have some connectivity. These aren't standalone instances, is what I'm expressing. This tabernacle pattern isn't just what the children of Israel had in the wilderness. When we begin to read, we're going to see that there's a pattern. This pattern extends all the way down into Egypt and then all the way up into the most holy places. Don't just keep that pattern here. We're applying it to the whole story. That's why I'm saying we have to have a little bit of liberty and a little bit of an open heart and an open mind to see, yes, this is where this tabernacle pattern was built. When Moses came down his second time, they began to work on it. Took them a year to put this tabernacle together. You follow? And to put the furnishings in here. And to begin to move this tabernacle all around. But what I'm expressing, what we're going to read here, is that we now can see how this tabernacle encompasses the whole migratory pattern. And we begin at the bottom of page 127. And let's pick it up. Because all I'm going to want, if one of you can get the New Testament scriptures out of each of these sections, because the other ones are the institution. The other scriptures that go along with this, each one of these sections, are the institution. That's what we've gone over time and time again. And when people get, they say, oh, again, why? Because this is the institution. If you don't start off right, you're not going to end up right. And what we're going to say, if you start off right, you'll see how Yahshua made it end up right. Because it's how he fulfilled that which they did in this migratory pattern based off the tabernacle pattern. And hopeful that someone might get something out of it. So let's start with the first plane. Dr. Kenny is expressing it as the first plane.
The first plane is represented in the migratory pattern by the door, or entrance into the houses of the Israelites, on which the blood of the lamb was put on the lintel and two side posts.
Now, everybody knows about that. See, but society, they have that blood on the outside of the doorpost. look at Christmas cards and things of that nature. That's what I'm saying. They don't understand that this blood was put on the inside of their houses. You follow? Alone. Keep reading.
And is compared to the gate or entrance.
Now look. It's compared to the gate or entrance. Read.
Into the tabernacle. And was fulfilled by Yahshua when he said, enter in at the straight gate.
Now, this door was the door. The door, the first step is the door or the gate. And we're referencing it as the door. So down here in Egypt, the children of Israel, when they went into, in order to do this Passover, they went in through the door. That's the start down here with the children of Israel in Egypt. And that's synonymous to this straight gate that we have here depicted on this chart. And Yahshua said, Matthew 7:13. All I'm going to want is this, the New Testament ones.
Matthew 7:13. Enter ye in by the narrow gate, mm-hmm. for wide is the gate, mm-hmm. and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, mm-hmm. and many there be which go in thereat.
Now, that's just what Yahshua is expressing. This is the straight gate, and this is why you have the migratory pattern, comparing it to the tabernacle, and why Yahshua, that's a fulfillment of this step. That statement, what Yahshua says, does, is a fulfillment of everything that he's doing in this migratory pattern, in this instance, second plane.
The second plane is represented in the migratory pattern by the slaying and eating of the Paschal Lamb, mm-hmm. in preparedness to leave out of Egypt, mm-hmm. and is compared to the sacrifice of sin offering on the altar, mm-hmm. in the outer court of the tabernacle.
So that's the comparison. That lamb that they had as a Passover that every household had to get is compared to what they're going to have to do with put their sacrifice on this altar according to this tabernacle. You follow? Keep reading.
And was fulfilled by the prepared body of Yahshua, the Passover lamb, slain from the sins of the world.
Now that's Yahshua fulfilling this Passover and this altar being set up. 1 Corinthians 5:7. You see what I'm saying? Now there's other scriptures that set up of why this lamb, you know, Exodus the 12th chapter, you have when Yahweh told Moses and Aaron to get the Passover. You can read this out of the textbook. But that's the institution of what Yahshua is going to be fulfilling. Read it.
1 Corinthians 5:7. Mm-hmm. Get rid of the old leaven that you may be bread of a new baking, mm-hmm. as it were unleavened Passover bread. Mm-hmm. For the Messiah, our Passover, was sacrificed, mm-hmm. for us.
Now right there, that's letting you know to see according to this pattern that Yahshua was the sacrifice and was the true Passover. This is why the Passover, he's fulfilling this instance. That's what we're seeing Yahshua doing. Plane 3.
The third plane is represented in the migratory pattern by the baptism of the Israelites in the cloud and in the sea, mm-hmm. as they fled from the Egyptians.
Mm-hmm. And everybody remember the story, right? Egypt, Pharaoh and his hosts, chariots and all. But we slow it down and we're seeing what? Keep reading.
And is compared to the brazen laver in the court of the tabernacle.
Now, this plane or this step, these are just the seven steps that we talk about the tabernacle pattern is. We're just calling them planes now. And we're planes once because we're comparing the migratory pattern to the tabernacle pattern. Now, in this plane, they went into the Red Sea. And this is going to be likened to this brazen altar or brazen laver. I'm sorry. Read. Keep reading.
Tabernacle for washing and cleansing purposes, mm-hmm. and fulfilled by Yahshua by washing the disciples' feet.
John 13:4. Now, this is the washing of the disciples' feet. that we have depicted here on this plate. And this is why we can come over and have this Assembly of Yahweh plate here, or the outpouring of the Holy Spirit plate. We're seeing. Down here you had that blood. Remember, they had to drink, right? But he's saying that that was a type of that blood. This is the bloodline on this plate. The bloodline of them drinking that wine was the blood under Yahshua the Messiah. I need to get it, I guess. What is it? I think maybe Hebrews 9:17. What is it? Matthew 26:26. Grab me that first, since I went that way. Because we're going to start working on this lower plate of the blood, water, spirit, 40, and ascension principles.
Matthew 26:26.
It should be it. Mm-hmm.
And as they were eating, Yahshua took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament.
That's the blood principle in this plate right here. That's the blood principle, and that's why they're down here. That's why they're in. Remember, this is outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He did this before the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So we're showing that this is a blood principle. Got it on here? Yeah. This is the blood principle in this plate, and now we're going to about to read the washing principle there in 1 Corinthians. Okay? Just wanted to bring that point out. Keep reading. That's good with Matthew 26.
You want John 13:4-5
yes,
now,
sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. He riseth from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poureth water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then come he to Simon Peter, and Peter said unto him, Rabbi, dost thou wash my feet? Yahshua answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not.
See, they didn't know, the children of Israel. They didn't know about what he was doing. And the whole world thinks that they were drinking, or they drink the communion now. They have the blood, the bread, the little wafer, and the grape wine, because they don't know. Peter and them didn't know at the then known time. That's what the previous speaker was talking about. They didn't know about these works back here, about why and what they were doing. Right. Now, since the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, we now do know. And we're expressing that we use the law and the prophets that Yahshua says not going to destroy, because we're going to need them for us to see why he did all of what he did. And the previous speaker said, if books could be written about all the things that Yahshua did, there'd be too many. It'd be a plethora. We don't have time to read. We already got a plethora number of books now. But we're using what we already have, which is sufficient, even with the errors in the Bible, because we can correct it and we can go forth, because nothing's perfect in the flesh. Let's just be honest. You're not perfect. I'm not perfect. There's nothing perfect. Even if the perfect car is not perfect, or the perfect person that you think is perfect is not perfect. Nothing that's built new is perfect if it's in the flesh. If you can see it, touch it, hear it, taste it, smell it, it's not perfect. Not universally perfect. That's what I'm expressing. And we're talking about a universal perfect God doctrine that would save a person's soul from out of a dark state of understanding. And now we're understanding about that door, about why that door is important that was in the houses of the children of Israel. We're understanding about that lamb that they had to take out here. It wasn't just no ordinary lamb. Yahshua Messiah was fulfilling these things. And we're seeing now about this laver, about them being buried in this Red Sea. And then how Yahshua Messiah was washing their feet. See, you don't have to. See, how would a person know that they put sacrifices on here? And they washed and they cleaned within this laver. We don't often see that. And people may not know that they washed the high priest in this laver, and not realizing that this laver also points to this washing of the disciples' feet. That's why I say you have to have an open, you got to expand a little bit in your thinking sometime. It's not always just the sacrifices was washed up in here. You follow? And they had to put that, we put that lamb on this grate here, or this altar. But remember, they had to put that blood on the four corners here too. We've heard this so many times, sometimes we forget. As the previous speaker oftentimes said last time, that people leave out of here and they think they know and they're feeling good, and then years later they say, damn, I got to come back. I forgot some stuff. Well, these are jots and tittles, people. And these are the things that keep us steadfast in the know. For when they people come back, we got to know. What is. It's not just pointing to the washings of the animals. It has to understand that's the washing of the disciples' feet. We are creatures too. And we had to be cleaned. And even the high priest and the two low priests. You follow? So these are the points that we're expressing. Let's keep running. We got a little bit of time. Go to the fourth plane.
The fourth plane is represented in mm-hmm. the migratory pattern mm-hmm. by the parting of the waters mm-hmm. of the Red Sea.
Now look, you're still with the Red Sea, and you're going to use it for two. They were baptized, and they didn't get wet. That's the key point. They went across on dry ground, but yet they got baptized. Go figure. And now this is also the door by which they went through. Two or one fold. So people are wondering if there's something separate somewhere else. You're using the same demarcation for two different principles. One principle is a baptism. Ironically, they didn't get wet, but yet it was a baptism. They were immersed, but they weren't immersed in physical water.
Right.
It's a type. It's a shadow. It's a principle. And then this is also the door. Let's keep reading.
Forming an entrance into the wilderness
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and is compared to the first veil or door of the tabernacle.
See right here? It's the veil or door. Person said, well, I went to the first veil. Hey, you're knowing, if you're understanding, this blue, purple, and scarlet veil is akin to the door. Because this would divide the holy place from the court round about. And now there's also the door. You follow? Let's keep reading.
And was fulfilled by Yahshua.
Now look, all of these things have to be fulfilled. That's what Matthew 5:17 is talking about. But we got to know, or our faith is coming when we know and see how Yahshua is fulfilling these things. That's the beauty. That it wasn't just some happenstance that they were going through some water. And how this water was actually an immersion. This water, the divider of the water, was actually a door into the holy place. And the Yahshua is what? Read.
By Yahshua the Messiah, who said, I am the door.
Mm-hmm.
By me, if any man enter, he shall be saved.
Everybody sees it at home and on YouTube. Grab your scriptures or grab your book and you hit John 10:9. You have it? Go ahead and read right quick.
I'm pulling it up right now. It just takes a second to do that.
Okay, John 10:9.
Mm-hmm.
I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved,
mm-hmm.
and shall go in and out mm-hmm. and find pasture.
Now look, in this tabernacle, it's just better depicted here. This is the sanctuary. This was the tent. This was the veil that they went in. The high priest and the two low priests could come in and out of here in order to do their service and find pasture. Yahshua was saying, we can come in and out of here. And remember, only the Levites were coming in and out of here. Because we go up on up further, we're going to get the Levites. We're going to get Melchizedek and them. And we're going to see how that ministry is the ministry that we're falling under. You follow? And though this is why Yahshua says that he's the door. You're looking at this principle here on this tabernacle. And also seeing that in the Red Sea is likened to the door into here. into this holy place, because that's where they were working. Didn't they wander all around at four steps? Didn't you have from the door to the lights, the lampstand to the altar of incense, and the incense to the table, and the table back to the door? They had to go around that four, is 40. They were 10 feet apart, right, Doc? You got 40 feet right there. 40 years in the wilderness.
40 days. Tarrying after the resurrection.
And Yahshua fulfilling it. 40 days after he resurrected into the wilderness. Death, that lamb.
The principle of 1 hour.
Death, the burial or the immersion. Death, burial, and then the resurrection into the wilderness. And then tarrying for 40 days. And him and them tarrying here for 40 years after coming through this door. Number five, plane.
The fifth plane is represented in the migratory pattern by the wilderness of Sinai.
The whole the wilderness of Sinai, read.
Where Israel received the law and tabernacle with its ceremonies.
Okay.
With the presence of Elohim among them, and is compared to the sanctuary of the tabernacle with its furniture for ceremonial purposes.
With the furniture, we're keeping it in principle now. All the wilderness is the holy place, and now we're in the holy place, and we're going to go through each of these points. Read.
Overlaid with gold.
That's the lamp. That's the candlestick. Read.
And fulfilled by Yahshua. Mm-hmm. Who said, I am the light of the world, the bread of life.
The bread that table of shoe bread. He's that candlestick, the seven branch candlestick. That's Yahshua. He's that bread that the ministers had to eat. And are we eating on Yahshua right now? That's that bread or that gospel. Keep reading.
And intercessor.
And he didn't say he's going to be the intercessor between Yahweh and man. Not no pope. You follow? These are the things that we're getting to become aware of. And that's what they did here in the wilderness. Because that's where the tabernacle was reared up in first. You follow? Let's skip that. Let's go ahead and go to six. Times of the essence.
The sixth plane is represented in the migratory pattern by the party.
Just keep it on this page. That way people at home can get the scriptures if they so choose, want to see the institutions and the fulfillment. All right, I'm not going to go back to the scriptures because we're having it read already.
All right, sounds good.
Go.
By the parting of the River Jordan, forming the second veil between the wilderness of Sinai and Canaan land.
Okay.
And is compared to the dividing veil of the blue, purple, and scarlet, which hung between the sanctuary and the most holy place in the tabernacle.
Okay.
And was fulfilled by Yahshua the Messiah when he took off the veil of his flesh and ascended into heaven.
When he took off the veil, when the veil in the temple was rent in twain, when he died in that sixth hour of that day at 12 noon, when that veil was ripped in the temple, you follow? That's that veil, the River Jordan, that we're expressing. And I said it earlier, not everybody that was of Israel went across the Red Sea, that were out of Egypt. Only the offspring, or that new man of an understanding that we're going to be able to then now see and operate and move and have our being. Right now, we're living and moving and having our being within Yahweh, but we don't know what's going on. That's what the whole world is demonstrating. But to have the full bounty of understanding Yahweh Elohim in this state while on earth before you take off the flesh is the kingdom, is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit after going through this veil. But you have to put in work down through here. That's where all the time was spent. We just said earlier that they only went up into this most holy place one time a year, and only one person got to do that. In that one day, they went in here three times. You correct, boss. They did do that, indeed. One for himself, the high priest. Then one time for the people. And then one time into the sanctuary for this purpose, for the cleansing of the sanctuary. You're correct. Thank you. Whew, Doc, I'll be on it, man. Number six. I think we just did six, right?
Yeah,
we just did. Let's hit seven right quick.
The seventh plane is represented in the migratory pattern by the Israelites entering Canaan or the Promised Land.
The Promised Land. How about it? Keep going.
Their final earthly inheritance.
That would liken to the, it is correlative. That was their inheritance. Not Gentiles. Not Africans, Asians, or anything else you want to talk about. At this known time, it was for them only. That means that the law that they received down here in the wilderness of Sinai wasn't given to everybody. It was only given to them Jews. That's another witness as to say that this was the Holy Land. I ain't running over to Jerusalem trying to get me a plot of land saying that was for my father Moses or that was given to my people. And no, people are not saying that, but they want to keep this law. You should be fighting for Jerusalem if you're going to fight for this law. It wasn't for you. Keep reading.
And is compared to the most holy place mm-hmm. in the tabernacle,
mm-hmm.
a type of heaven, and right. was fulfilled by Yahshua the Messiah,
mm-hmm.
who entered not into the holy places made with hands, but into heaven itself.
Now, I wish I had time. I don't have time because he's talking about here with this Melchizedek, with this priesthood, and about how Melchizedek was that first high priest. Don't need it. You get it. Read. Hebrews 6:19 right quick. Then I'm going to go at 9:24. I think it's 6:19.
Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil,
mm-hmm.
whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Yahshua made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
You see what I'm saying? Entering in here is what we're going to be able to look at because we're talking about Abraham had that promise. We're taking that round trip and getting back into this most holy place, and it's talking about Abraham with Melchizedek being that high priest and Yahshua coming in as the order of Melchizedek, supersede Melchizedek. And it talks about, when you read about that story with Abraham and Melchizedek, not after coming in with he had neither mother or father. You follow? And it goes back to saying that anyone know that Yahshua Messiah didn't have a mother or father either. But these are principles and types. As you go through these, you can see the institution and the fulfillment of Yahshua Messiah through here to give us a faith in the scriptures, in the story. So you don't have to come up with any other explanation for Yahshua the Messiah. He needs no other explanation of who and what he is. And you don't need no explanation to know who and what you are, having that which is inside of us. Grab me, do we have 9:24? I think so. I'll be done.
Hebrews 9:24. For the Messiah is not entered into the holy places made with hands,
mm-hmm.
which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself,
mm-hmm.
now to appear in the presence of Yahweh for us.
So Yahshua, having gone into this most holy place, or having ascended unto the Father, he did it for us. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
Nor yet that he should offer himself often
mm-hmm.
as the high priest enter into the holy place every year with other blood.
That's what the doctor just pointed out. He went in here with this blood three times on that one day on the Day of Atonement. That's what the high priest had to do. That was a type and a shadow that he had to do that every year. But what Yahshua do? Read.
For then must he often have suffered since uh-huh. the foundation of the world.
Uh-huh. That's just that lamb slain before the foundation of the world, read.
But now.
But now, listen, after all of this, what? Read?
But now, once in the end of the age.
One time at the end of the age.
Hath he appeared to put away sin.
Yes.
By the sacrifice of himself.
Of himself. Or that lamb that he spoke is a type and a shadow of. And it was this lamb that he died, buried, and resurrected. Keep reading.
And as it is appointed unto men once to die.
That's right.
But after this, the judgment. So the Messiah was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin offering unto salvation.
Hallelujah. And that's what we're looking at now. And this is why we have to know Yahshua the Messiah, know our Elohim, and that's because life eternal is to know. And when you know how Yahshua Messiah is the Savior of your world or of your consciousness or your state of understanding about your Creator, in order to be able to prove and to deny and be able to point out that beast man of sin anywhere, but primarily within you, whereby you can have some stability and not be tossed to and fro. You follow? If you got anything out of tonight's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude today's class. Do we have any announcements? No? Okay. So we hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. During the Orlando Unity and Yah Symposium, we will not be holding classes here, so you'll be able to just view the classes that's happening in the symposium because they'll be going on at the same time that we would be having class. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.